to put it simply, something which is not a happy outcome. So there's two kinds of exits. One is a happy exit where you get acquired by Walmart, or you get acquired by Flipkart, Google, or something. The valuation is much higher than the time of investment. So everyone's happy. Investors are happy, employees are happy, founders are happy, everyone makes a good exit. A liquidation exit event is something where the exit valuation is lesser than what maybe investors put in that or things like that. So then, basically, it whatever the proceeds come in from a liquidation event, those have to be divided among the founders and VCs and all that. So what happens in a liquidation event? These are the terms in the term sheet that you should be cognizant of. Same thing where a down round is basically a funding at a lower valuation, and who owns the IP during liquidation? So you should talk about try and see if you can retain the IP. So Kanisha asked me to talk a little bit about IP protection. Normally I see IP as part of the company. The company is a mix of IP, its founders, its customers, its brand and everything, but some general do's and don'ts remember. So investors don't sign NDAs. I'm sure you all have talked to investors globally. Investors don't sell NDAs. So basically, don't tell investors anything that is valuable or very scarce to come. If it's that scarce, then leave it for a much more future discussion where you become much more comfortable with the investor, and the conversation point after term sheet, after share agreements have been signed, you're okay to disclose. So don't disclose something up front with the goal of, just charming them so they sign a term sheet. Because we don't sign NDAs, people can take the idea, do it around, take it to some other company and have it better, and it's your fault only, basically. So just remember, don't sign NDAs. Try and have some lock-ins like provisional patents. If you have filed for a patent at least, then it's in one sense it's public knowledge, because someone can do a patent search and see at least at a broad level what you're doing. So then you can talk about it. Again, try and keep it at a high level, If you're doing, if you're doing some P2P lending or something, or something in ARDR, something which is unique, just talk about it at a high level initially, so you get comfortable with the investor. And again, investors are investing in the company, which includes IP, the team, traction, brand, and all that. So look at as IP as one part of your overall team. Don't, it's not the only thing, nor is it insignificant. So it should be looked at it in, holistically in terms of your team as a company. Okay, this is now getting deep into finance, but there was some discussion of whether you should do debt or equity. Okay, so I just summarize this overall. I don't like debt. Most VCs don't like debt. Debt basically means you're taking a loan, which means you have fixed payments on a regular basis, and your income is variable as a startup it goes along. So you add two parameters. You add varying income and fixed costs. So it makes a startup very risky, basically, because the moment income dips, you still have to make that payment. You can go into loss very easily. And if income goes high also, you still have to service that debt. So essentially what happens is debt is a very old school instrument that was used to finance real estate and companies with assets and the traditional way of thinking of start a business and pick a bank loan and put collateral and all that. Don't do debt, just do equity throughout. Every round of funding, including friends, family and all that. Either it's just someone gives you money, says do it, your father and your brother and your uncle, even then I ideally give them equity. And then anyone you talk to after that, just do equity, basically. Because it's simple, philosophically someone is sharing your risk and sharing the upside, right? When you give equity, someone is risking you money and also enjoying the upside when you grow. So it's a way of balancing risk and reward for anyone that comes into your company. So by the same token, I don't like convertibles too much. A lot of people do it. Go deep into VC discussions. Convertibles are a way to just avoid evaluation discussion because people say, okay, just give me 20% discount on the next round. It's a lazy way of doing it. It's like saying, I don't know how to value a company. We'll do it. We'll worry about it when someone big comes in. So that's fine. I don't like it. It has a debt-like feel to it. Again, it's like some fixed payments, and then that adds up, and when someone invests, discount and all that. Value a company at every stage is not that hard. It's it's actually very hard, and because it's so hard, people have simplified a way of valuing startups in terms of, you know, comparables and some DCF models that work for startups. So just do valuation rounds, just do equity, and keep it simple. Now, in India, the debt ecosystem is coming into play in a bigger way for later rounds of funding. So when a startup is raising $5, $10 million of funding, what a debt person is saying is, okay, I'll put in another million. That happens because often founders at later stages don't want to dilute too much. So they're raising $5 million and they want to give only 20% of the company. Investors saying, no, at $5 million, I need 25%, some situation like that. So what's happening is that they're saying, okay, I take $4 million in equity, give me 20%. I take $1 million in debt. Because when you take debt, you don't have to give equity out. So that is one rationale I kind of understand. Again, there's pros and cons about it. But when a startup is mature, its cash flows are defined, there's no risk of a company failing tomorrow. And where you don't want to dilute more than X percent, you want to retain control and things like that, it's okay to use debt as part of the mix. Debt along with equity is fine at that stage. Yeah, I think this is. So finally, equity dilution for accelerators. So we are an accelerator also. We do investment and acceleration as one thing. So for us, it's bundled together. The service we offer is the money as well as the acceleration. So it's for. But when you talk to accelerators in general, you just talk about equity or whatever some arrangements you have. Question was asked to me, how would you evaluate the value an accelerator gives to you and how much equity should you give? That was the question asked to me. So the advice to you is that look upon the acceleration process as some kind of an advisor. That they are doing this much, they're giving you office space, they're giving you AWS, they're giving you market access, 3-4 things. Just try and add it up and see how valuable that service is to you, and then decide if you had one person or a group that is giving you that service, how much equity would you be willing to divulge to that kind of person? That's the best way I can think of how you can value the services an accelerator is giving to you and give equity for that. So if you really want to get arithmetical, you know, calculate all the value the service has provided, divide that by your valuation, and give out that percent. Simple. So you add up, you know, office space, blah, blah, blah. Let's say it adds up to 5 crores, just as an example. And your valuation is 30 crores. So here's 5 by 6, 15%. As an example. Because startups always wonder, should I give 2%, should I give 4%, is 3.5% and all, there's no exact science to it. You know? This is one model, okay, just me, I would think of it as a startup. Just add up whatever you're getting from that accelerator, how valuable that is to you at your stage, and then use your valuation methodologies, and that's one way of arriving at how much equity you should negotiate with accelerator. And that's it.
Give me royalty for, let's say, 5 years at a particular value, and then it dips down to, let's say, very minuscule percentage for, you know, perpetuity. Percentage of revenue.
Yeah.
So what is your view on that? Is that a very, you know, good way to approach things? Because right now, let's say, for, I don't know what my valuation is, and even the investor might not know, you know, the true valuation at a very early stage.
So
which is why he does not want to take part in the equity. He's saying, just I'll give you the money which you're looking for,
right.
I'll invest in you, but what I'm looking for is this kind of a deal.
Right.
You give me certain percentages of your revenue till 5 years or 7 years, and then it dips down to a very minuscule value till perpetuity, or let's say about 15 odd years.
Right.
What is your view about that deal?
Good question. So one first question would be, why does an inventor want to participate in a startup in a more meaningful way?
Mm-hmm.
The typical answer would be is one of those, you know, propeller heads who just invents things and is not part of operations.
Mm-hmm.
He just wants value for his inventions. It's on a case-by-case basis. I don't think there's anything wrong with the percentage of revenue.
Mm-hmm.
You should just take a balance sheet approach to it, a P&L approach to it.
Mm-hmm.
So that, okay, I'm earning 100. These are my costs, and my profit was 5 rupees, let's say. Now, in addition to that, there's another 3% that I have to give out right from the top line. So it brings my profit down to 2%. So is that worth it or not? If it is, if it's still profitable, if it's kind of product where you can increase the price and accommodate this guy and still maintain profitability. If it is so, if it's something you're unique or valuable, then instead of 100 you can charge 110 and still give him 5 rupees and still have a profitability, then why not? But then how, you know, this question of how protectable it is, royalty, you know, it's rights around it, can you turn around and say no? No, I mean, you have to be very careful about structuring such agreements to kind of beyond a point at least have full rights over that product and technology. Because you know someone can always you know who owns the rights in the interim, who owns the rights to that, who owns the IP. At least the IP should be clearly claimed by the company, right? He can't turn around and say, oh, I created it, so now, you know, I decided that someone else is a better company to commercialize. So, commensurate with his claims on the cash flow, claims on the IP should remain with the person who actually does the work in commercializing. Or at least that's how a VC would look at it, let's put it that way. If I was an investor came into such a situation and say, oh, for 5 years they're giving him this much, and after that, 1%. I would first ask, so who actually owns it? Let's say there's a divorce, God forbid, in this scenario. Then it's, you know, that's when all these problems happen. And everything is good, everyone's happy, and nobody cares. You know, I find them 2% current life. But when there's any adverse situation, that's when problems start happening.
Right.
Roundabout way of answering that. Key thing is who owns the IP in case. If the person is all as equity, you know, which vests over some year, then it's fine, it's all with the company. He's in the ambit of the company then. Then it's easy. Yes. The moment this feature comes in, we are paying them stuff. No ifs or buts. Founding team has been rounded out, management team. There's no any friction happening in the first 2 years, so then it gets cleared out, so things rounded out. There's tech, there's marketing, there's finances, all well developed. So there's no big holes. So if holes are there, there's clear. You know, I know these three candidates. The moment I have funding, I can afford them, and I have that kind of thing. We have thought out the entire C-level team. If those three, four things are there, and the things I spoke about, big market, team, traction, you know, some IP or lead, they're ready for pre-series A. Probably beyond pre-series A, but at least they're well ready for pre-series A. And they're speaking to position of strength. If you are in a scenario where, oh, I put friends, family, the money is running out, life and death situation, I'm going to fail, I'll go back to corporate life, all that kind of thing, it's fine, that's reality, but that is less an ideal situation for a startup. So always get friendly money and grow it to a point where you're in a position of strength. At least I can operate, I don't need any money. I will take money for growth, not for survival. Yeah.
Yeah. There is no other player in the market whom you can reference to. So how do you value startup then?
So first of all, if someone comes to me and saying I'm doing something unique.
And startup doesn't have a revenue.
So those situations are hard for sure. Still there has to be some scientific way of modeling future revenue. You know, building a product or a service. Charge this much, and it's ready. Okay, then I will start asking you questions around. Okay, you're saying you'll charge 5,000 rupees per month. Why? So you tell me currently it costs all my customers 10,000 rupees to do the same thing. I'm cutting it by half, so I'm sharing because of my technology. The cost is getting reduced to zero. So for some believable reason. So okay, so 5,000 is a plausible price. So basically, I ask a set of questions to. Challenge your cash flows, or not challenge, but in a good way, question your cash flows, and then come up with a believable set of metrics to judge your startup. So there's something in the finance world called DCF, like discounted cash flow. It's very often used. It's hard to do for startups because there's so much variability in revenue and cost, and anything can change in the world. But there has to be some way of coming to the range. Right? So one is DCF, and one is comparable valuation. Might not be a directly comparable company, but someone similar to you, something adjacent to you. What were they valued at in the last round or current those form 2-3 data points around which we try and triangulate or arrive at a valuation.
And how do you go about if you have to compare it with some company in US? The scale at which the US customers pay is very different from scale at which in India. So you can't directly compare the company in US and the company in India.
Yeah, don't try and do that. I would my advice, we try not to do it. If you are evaluating an Indian company, we just use Indian parameters. In some cases, media and entertainment could be more valuable in India because, you know, the consumer market in India. The consumer market in India is much larger. Raw numbers, 1 billion people versus 3 million and something like that. So, long story short, we don't try to cross-border comparables because it's companies are valued very different in India. Just go 2 hours away in Singapore, companies are valued very different. You go to Hong Kong, you can go to Malaysia, Indonesia, some weird local thing, right? Probably Singapore is a good example where a fintech startup just magically is valued 25% more because fintech startups find it easier to find exits. Once, you know, even Flipkart and companies are going to Singapore, you know, just to incorporate there because it's easier to do M&A in Singapore, right? Just Singapore corporation. So, but the moment it's easier to do M&A in Singapore, then automatically valuation goes up. So, just do local comparisons. Corporations have money to pay. In India, we don't like B2B because corporations don't appreciate software. Sad, but we have always traditionally till date, best I can tell, we understood services, but we don't understand products. But a B2B startup like Freshdesk, or Zoom, which is built in India but for the world, it's perfect. India engineering, India talent, low cost base. Can you just put up on a server on AWS and with a credit card, anyone in the world can buy it? That's perfect. We love those kind of companies. People in Europe, US have much fewer issues with paying for a software. And their culture is such, they can go to a website, they'll see a couple of YouTube videos, they'll see LinkedIn profiles. The decision making process is very different. Here you have to go and meet, shake handshakes, have tea, coffee 10 times, then payments and all that. So we don't like B2B. If someone came to be with a B2B, like for the chemical industry in India, or cement industry in fact, forget it. You're not going to get money, and no one's going to get money for it. Light years. But B2C in India is again e-commerce in India because of just raw size of the market is such. Certain game-changing things can be done in India. But ideally, you mitigate a risk by having overseas market, right? And much easier to sell, much more kind of, I would say, loyalty and, you know, ethics about paying for the product that you use is higher than. Smart people will see this is so much time saving and productivity improvement. I'll pay for this $5,000 a month for eternity. So build something like that which has regular use, which someone have to do all the time every day, which has value, which saves time, effort, compliance, headache, something that is a necessary evil that has to be done, can be done better by a software. And build an early set of corporations as early users who are loyal users that keep using the software and build on top of it.